deep in the Rocky Mountains.
10.
Some strange folk prowl along the tree line. Even the most tenacious young men can find themselves outmatched. This time, it's just a paintball game.
He got you, man.
Had this been a real battle, it'd be dead meat.
But soon, one member of this unit will be firing real bullets.
I have no control over other people.
And drenching this mountain in blood. A few days after a snowless Christmas, in a remote area just outside of Colorado Springs, the Teller County Sheriff's Office gets a distressed call from a concerned son.
Teller County Sheriff's Department, this is Betty.
I'm kind of worried about my parents and my nephew. Several people have been calling. No returns on messages. We're all freaked out. We don't know what's going on.
And your parents' names?
Joanna and Carl Dutcher. And my nephew's up there, too.
And his name?
Tony.
Okay, well, get someone out there.
The house was in a pretty secluded area. Not a lot of close neighbors. Carl and Joanna Dutcher were a retired couple.
Tony Dutcher is their grandson.
Sheriff's Department! Police, anybody home?
The deputies decide to let themselves in.
There was no signs of forced entry. We were immediately met by a little white dog that was very nervous.
The dog needed water and was very hungry.
We step into the house. We noticed Carl Dutcher laying in the hallway like he had backed up and fell against the wall. He had bloodstains on his shirt. He was deceased.
Dispatch, we got a 187 here.
Deputies make their way to the home's master suite. And find the bullet-riddled body of Joanna Dutcher.
She was deceased.
Dispatch, notify Four Kings, we have another 187.
Got two victims, two down, two. One looks like she may have a gunshot wound or trauma in the head.
Looks like the police have an unthinkable double homicide on their hands. And the murdered couple's grandson, Tony, is still MIA. 30 minutes later, a homicide squad swarms the scene.
What do we have here?
We have two victims. This one here, he has two gunshot wounds.
It was clear that Carl Dutcher had been shot twice.
It was probably a high-powered rifle rather than a handgun. A high-powered rifle is going to have a smaller entry hole and a larger exit.
We noticed some shell casings that were in the hallway, and they were from an AK-47.
For Carl Dutcher, death came quick. Wife Joanna, on the other hand, endured a more drawn-out demise.
There were bullet holes in the door. There were blood on the floor. Right away, it became apparent that she was trying to hold the door shut, and someone was shooting through the door.
One bullet struck the toilet bowl and being porcelain, it broke apart. This is a very violent, very brutal type of situation.
Why in the world would someone slaughter this isolated, elderly couple? The answer may lie in Carl's gun cabinet.
Carl was a gun dealer.
There was an empty gun scabbard, but there was no gun in it.
Maybe robbery was the motive.
But even with a possible motive, big mysteries still linger. Where is the murdered couple's grandson, Tony? As detectives ponder, something points them in the right direction.
I went outside smoking a cigarette, and I looked on the hill, and you could see some type of structure up there.
Let's go check it out.
With two dead bodies already at the scene, the police approach with caution. Then they enter the ramshackle fort.
Clear.
It was kind of a mess. Different kind of games, maybe some food items and some soft drinks.
Detectives also see something strange jutting out of a sleeping bag in a corner of the shack.
It's a bloody arm with a bloody watch. And the watch had an orange flame design on it.
Check that sleeping bag.
We find a very gruesome young man. His throat had been slashed. Almost totally decapitated.
The speculation was right away that it was Tony Dutcher.
Death has a very particular smell. I've seen gunshot wounds, but I had never encountered anything as gruesome.
This is a triple homicide.
That evening, detectives meet with Tony's mother, Jennifer, and reveal that her in-laws have been murdered. However, they haven't yet told her Tony could be a third victim.
He said he'd call me and wish me Happy New Year. And I said, write down my cell phone number because I might not be at home. But he didn't call. He never called. I hope he just saw something and got scared and ran. That's what I hope.
They still need to positively ID their third teenaged victim.
Do you recognize this watch?
It's my son's watch.
I had bought Tony a leather watch with flames to match his wallet. And so when they started talking about this watch, that's how I found out.
God, you'd be my loved most in 9 months.
It is finally confirmed. The third victim is indeed Tony Dutcher.
I started asking a lot of background questions about what Tony was like.
Can you tell me a little bit about Tony?
What did he like to do? Why would he have been in the mountains?
He would hike up and down that the dirt road out in front of their house. You know, he'd go down it and back. He usually would take walkie-talkies. He'd tell Carl, I'm right here, man.
I told them Tony loved being outside, and he loved his grandparents' house. It was his favorite place. When he was at Carl and Joanna's, he got to be a boy.
That's perfect. Oh. You got it right there.
It's like it's flying over the tree.
Hey, guys. Who wants some hot chocolate?
Yeah.
There you go.
Thank you.
We get some too, right?
Absolutely.
He got to spend time with his grandparents.
I love you all. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Christmas.
They loved each other so much.
Grandpa, I want you to open this.
All right, okay. I was gonna open it first tomorrow. But
the grandparents, they were country folks, as they say.
Oh, that's beautiful.
What is it?
It's a conch shell.
Really?
Yeah.
It's kind of small for a conch.
Carl was a retired military man, a veteran.
And Joanna was such a people person and so outgoing and never met a stranger. She was always dancing and smiling and laughing.
Can you tell me a little bit about his friends?
Jennifer also explains the fort where Tony's body was discovered had been constructed the previous summer by Tony and his best friend, Isaac Grimes.
Tony and Isaac were friends for many years, through junior high and into high school. Isaac was incredibly intelligent and very witty.
Nice shot.
He was just a good kid.
Jennifer tells us that Isaac Grimes was supposed to have been up camping with Tony Dutcher at the Dutcher home on New Year's Eve. It concerned me greatly. Was Isaac also a victim that we hadn't found?
Or could Isaac be the one with blood on his hands? Detectives in the mountain hamlet of Guffey, Colorado, are worried their first ever triple murder could soon be upgraded to quadruple homicide.
When they hear Isaac was supposed to be there at the murder scene, they figure maybe he got killed at the same time. We have to get over to Isaac's house.
Thankfully, Isaac Grimes is alive and well.
He was kind of shook up by the fact that Tony was dead, but he acted pretty much like a normal kid.
He's a very quiet boy, intelligent, but also I could tell he's very nervous.
Isaac says he feels guilty. He says, I was supposed to be with Tony on New Year's Eve.
However, rather than spend December 31st with his lifelong friend, Isaac had opted to get rowdy with some new upperclassmen pals, Jonathan Matheny and Glenn Urban.
Big money, big money. Hey!
Do you want my dad to come in here and drop the hammer on all of us?
Oh, relax, man. It's New Year's.
The three friends loved to hang out in Glenn's garage metal workshop, where 17-year-old Jonathan comes out of his shell.
Woo! Oh, man, that's strong.
Jonathan Matheny, he was bigger, but he was shy. John was quiet at first until you actually got to know him.
Uh-oh.
Whoa!
Damn it, Jonathan, what are you doing? Do you know what alcohol does to the grease of this thing?
Yeah, don't you know, man? Come on.
I know his father wasn't really around, so John definitely wanted somebody to kind of lead him along the way. Jonathan was always looking for acceptance.
Despite this timid demeanor, Jonathan possesses a special something that virtually guarantees him high school camaraderie.
Okay, buddy. Let's see how you like it.
Hey, man. Hey, stop. You don't just spray a man's car. This is a fine piece of machinery.
He had a car, and he would chauffeur friends around, and that made him more popular.
Look what we have here.
Hey.
Come on, stop playing around. Give me these.
I'm sorry, Jonathan. These don't seem like they're in your size.
While Jonathan derives status from his ride, gearhead Glenn would rather fix a car than drive one.
That's ridiculous.
Glenn was mechanically inclined. He liked to tinker in the garage. He liked to build things.
According to Isaac, after hanging out at Glenn's, he and Jonathan called it an early night.
They go back to Jonathan's house.
10 o'clock on New Year's. Looks like I can't either.
And Isaac spent the night with Jonathan in his room.
We With best friend Isaac's alibi looking airtight, detectives ask if he can help spot any crucial clues that they've missed.
We're asking Isaac Grimes when he last saw Tony. He told me it was at school as they were leaving for Christmas break.
I asked when he went to the mountains, what did he take? What kind of clothing would he have? And we got on the subject of the watch that we'd found on Tony, and Isaac said something to the effect of, oh yeah, he has this watch with orange flame design on it.
Detectives are relieved Isaac isn't a fourth victim, but now they're fresh out of potential suspects. Thankfully, a surprise visit from a local student named Anthony soon kicks the investigation back into high gear.
Anthony was a pretty good kid. His gut told him something was wrong, and it was eating at him. So he says, I have something to tell you.
So basically, me and Glenn are friends, and he hangs out with that whole crew. Isaac, Jonathan, the other guys. And we're in the shop one day, making these chess pieces for class.
Dude.
These are so much better than the last batch.
No, thanks, man. Mm-hmm.
2 days after the murders, Jonathan Matheny pulls up to Glenn's workshop with the mysterious final member of this crew in the back seat. Simon Sue, whose family has immigrated here from Guyana. He's far from your typical high school student.
Who's that?
Simon Sue. He was little, he was quiet, but for a guy who's only 5'2", 5'3", was really intimidating.
John Matheny is the driver for Simon Sue. John Matheny always picked up Simon from the school, give him a ride.
Something about the kid, you didn't want to mess with him. He invoked the same kind of feelings that, like, you'd get watching a snake waiting to strike.
Hey, watch it!
You watch it.
But Simon was an intelligent guy. In school, Simon was a top-class chess player.
Simon, what can I do for you?
He looked at life as though it was a series of chess moves. He's gonna be able to outthink you or outmove you.
It's then that things take a turn for the surreal.
Simon Sue told Glenn to destroy this assault rifle, an AK-47.
The same make as the murder weapon.
I can do that.
Simon Sue and his driver, Jonathan, then depart as quickly as they came.
Anthony's thinking, now that's odd. Why would anyone want a gun destroyed? Anthony even asks Glenn, why are you doing this?
You doing it?
It's no biggie. I do odd jobs for him all the time.
But Anthony is still concerned. Of course, detectives won't know if Simon's AK was the murder weapon until they can track it down.
At this point, we really didn't know much about Simon other than his name. But we knew it's time to interview Glenn Urban.
Detectives are hoping the gearhead can lead them right to the rifle. They don't yet suspect that the deeper they dig, the more twisted this story gets. Four days after the Dutcher triple homicide, Colorado detectives have been hearing tales of New Year's Eve celebrations and assault rifles. And at the center of both these accounts is local high schooler Glenn Urban. Now, Gearhead Glenn finds himself in the hot seat.
Can you tell me where you were on New Year's Eve?
I was at a metal shop with Isaac and Jonathan.
At first, Glenn lends support to his friend Isaac's New Year's Eve alibi.
Glen Urban stuck with the story of Isaac Grimes and John Matheny being at Glen Urban's drinking rum.
And what about destroying that rifle for Simon Sue?
Did Simon ask you to destroy an AK-47 for him?
It was no big deal. I do a lot of different odd jobs for Simon.
How did you destroy it? Chopped off. So I took it. I cut it off in pieces, not this big.
Glenn says he's been doing odd jobs for Simon since last fall.
He was probably one of the only guys that respected my talents.
Glenn was somewhat flattered that somebody at last paid attention to his abilities as a mechanic.
Their working relationship began the day Simon invited Glenn over to show off a most unusual collection.
Glenn was impressed with the catch of guns that Simon had.
The pride of Simon's hoard, a real, fully functional Uzi submachine gun.
Is this an Uzi?
Simon Sue asked Glenn Urban to make some type of handle for a Uzi machine gun.
According to detectives, for Glenn, the chance to work on a machine gun was simply too enticing to pass up.
Originally, I thought this was a good idea. I thought I was going to get filled with stuff. And he said that he would improve my body life. If I needed something, he could come get it for me. And that's why I said, okay, I'll help you out.
Hey, Simon, I just finished.
Glenn Urban did, in fact, make this handle.
Pretty cool, right?
And he did a great job. So he was rewarded with a brand new saw.
What's this?
Payment for a job well done.
And Simon says, I can get this and a lot more. Keep up the good work. Keep doing stuff for me. There's a lot more where this came from.
I do understand that destroying evidence is a serious crime.
I didn't know it was evidence at the time. I swear.
The more detectives hear about gun-obsessed Simon Sue, the more convinced they are he's tangled up in the Dutcher killings. And probably a lot more. However, rather than go right at the allegedly brilliant chess master, detectives opt to play it smart and skewer one of his pawns.
Agent Sadar gets a hold of John Matheny, the driver for Simon Sue, and we meet at the Colorado Springs Police Department.
Where were you on New Year's Eve?
When asked for an alibi, Jonathan tells me the same thing. He picked Isaac Grimes up. They went to Glenn Urban's house.
He went over to Glenn Urban's, parked behind his garage. And just went in. I had a bottle of Eldorado, 5-year-old rum.
He had all the details in his memory.
The night of New Year's Eve, then your car never left?
No, never left my property.
Okay, that it, night. It never
12
left.
O'clock, 7, you know, whatever, 9 o'clock, any of that time, it right. Never left from when I was at home.
And he denies any involvement whatsoever in the murders of the Dutchers.
Jonathan then insists his friend Simon Sue's amateur arsenal has nothing to do with murder and asserts that Gearhead Glenn held back some information during his interview.
This is where the story gets really strange.
Simon's arsenal is not for murder. We're here to stop terrorists.
Jonathan starts telling a story that he belongs to an organization called the OARA, which is an acronym for Operations and Reconnaissance Agents. It's supposedly based in South America, out of Guyana somewhere.
And the group's general? None other than Guyanese immigrant Simon Sue.
This organization was made to actually get into a physical military type fight.
Simon trains his troops right here in Colorado. And part of that is steeling their nerves with challenges like Russian roulette.
So your boy's on the other side.
Simon ran it strictly as a military operation. They each had ranks, like in the military. They had different training scenarios. They did workouts, practiced with the weapons.
Having inspections, having rules, having orders given to them.
He's trying to toughen them so they can be up for the task, whatever that task is.
Jonathan explains even victim Tony was a one-time OARA soldier.
Come on, Isaac. Join us.
But things went south when Simon pushed his newest recruit a bit too far.
Stop it.
Tony.
Guys, this is
stupid. Stand down.
You stand down.
You are out of line.
You think I'm gonna take a bullet just to play army and be a part of your little club? You guys really wanna die to impress Simon?
And so he had words with Simon. And Simon was upset that he would question his authority.
Maybe if you're that dumb, then you all deserve it.
Tony quits the militia, making an enemy of General Simon Sue.
Tony,
forget about him.
After that, Tony did not hang out with those boys.
Jonathan says once he had pledged himself to the OARA, there was no turning back.
John says you can't leave the OARA, or else you'll be killed and maybe your family will be killed. Once you're in for life. And yeah, I think they took it very seriously.
Detectives can't yet prove it, but they're now convinced the Dutcher murders must be connected to these teens' military fantasies. To crack the case, they'll need to finally go nose to nose with the general himself. Jonathan Matheny claims there's a teenage militia operating right out of Colorado Springs, headed up by a diminutive 19-year-old named Simon Sue.
We served a search warrant on Simon Sue's home and learned a whole lot of things. He had a lot of ammunition, a lot of military-type paraphernalia.
But that's not all.
Hello. Wow, what's that?
In the upstairs bedroom, we uncovered 20 or 30 different assault-type rifles.
And in Simon's closet, the most intriguing discovery yet.
We find an organizational chart. It says OARA and has the names John, Isaac, and Glenn Urban, and titles of military-type ranks. There was a military-type shirt that had OARA sewn on it. It's very apparent that, yes, what John was saying is true.
Down at the station, police bring in Simon Sue for an interview.
Simon Sue is an interesting young man. He wants to play mind games.
Detectives decide to ask him about his crew of military wannabes.
We did have a little group, but it wasn't like that.
This group, did you give it a title or a name?
Yeah, we called it OARA.
O-A-R-A. And what does that stand for?
Just Operations and Reconnaissance Agents. It was just a thing, you know, got off a movie.
All right. What's the mission of this group?
Just to be good citizens.
Simon is calling it training, but most people would consider the group's activities war games. Bordering on torture.
All these boys, they had to give money to Simon to help support this military organization.
And Isaac would sometimes lapse on his payments.
Please, man, I'm sorry.
Take this now or it's gonna get a lot worse.
Before the Christmas break, Isaac wasn't paying his proper dues.
In the OARA, Simon deals with insubordination using extreme measures.
Don't, please, I'm sorry.
Shut up.
No, go on.
Shut up.
Isaac was demoted, clear down to a lower rank within the organization.
And disciplined.
Anybody and everybody that has ever seen Simon Sue says he has the look of the devil.
Isaac, desperate to avoid Simon's torture, sold out his oldest friend, Tony.
Again.
By suggesting the OARA steal guns from the Dutcher cottage.
What are you gonna do to make amends?
Tony's grandparents, they have a whole gun cabinet full of guns. We can steal them, it'll be real easy.
And so Isaac decided to steal the guns from Tony's grandparents. And I honestly think that's the stupidest reason, but I think that's the reason.
Simon insists he rejected Isaac's suggestion and then knocks detectives back on their heels.
Tell me where you were December 31st, New Year's Eve.
I was in Canada.
He says he couldn't be involved in any of these murders. He's not even here.
Can anyone verify that?
Yes, I was with my family.
Simon's got an alibi, but admits he's not sure what Isaac might have done on his own initiative.
I have no control of over other people's minds and the nature and this and that. I'm not God.
That's kind of a big leap to make, to think that your buddy's whacked these people. There's got to be a little more than that.
I think Isaac killed Tony by cutting him in the neck.
But would Isaac really slit his best friend's throat? It's a question the dead boy's grieving mother, Jennifer, might be best equipped to answer. And police are leaving no stone unturned.
We go along in the conversation, and I asked Jennifer about what present did Tony get for Christmas. And she said one item in particular was a new watch with an orange flame design on it.
I don't know what to say. It's awesome.
As long as you're happy.
Hearing that the watch was a Christmas present stops detectives dead in their tracks. This very watch came up in an earlier conversation.
My initial interview with Isaac Grimes, he told me that he saw Tony's wristwatch before the boys were let out of school for Christmas break.
But if Isaac saw Tony's new wristwatch, he obviously saw it after Christmas.
There's no way Isaac could know about the watch unless he's lying to us and his alibi is phony.
Detectives now know Isaac has been hiding something all along.
How would you know about that watch?
Two weeks after the murders of Tony Dutcher and his grandparents, detectives are eager to put the screws to Tony's best bud, Isaac Grimes.
We called the Grimes family to clarify a few more things. At that point, we were confronting Isaac with the fact about the watch.
I have one credibility question for you, too, okay? We know from you today and the other day that the last time you saw Tony was like the week before Christmas. You describe the watch that Tony had with the flames on the band, and you say you saw it?
That's cool.
So we have that watch. But the problem is, his mom gave it to him for Christmas. And he opened it Christmas Day. So the question would become, how would you know about that watch?
He asked his dad to leave the room, and he asked me to leave the room.
Isaac is still dancing around, but his mom, highly religious, and his dad, they want the truth to come out.
You just tell the truth. And what it's gonna look like is that you end up there and you were involved in this. Were you?
Yeah.
Then you Isaac. Say every single thing that you know. You say every single thing that you said.
When pressed by his mom to finally tell the truth, Isaac only has one name on his lips.
It was Simon. It was all part of the plan, because it was for the OARA.
I think he genuinely was afraid that Simon would harm his family if he didn't obey.
That's a reason, not a confession. So police push Isaac further.
Answer the question to me. You did cut Tony's throat?
And with that nod, this group's whole house of lies starts to crumble.
I set up, you know, told Tony to be there.
Was part of it that you had to kill Tony? Did you help kill the Dutchers?
Isaac admits he went to the Dutcher cabin on New Year's Eve, planning to get back on Simon's good side by stealing the Dutchers' guns.
The night begins with Jonathan dropping Isaac off.
What's up, dude?
Hi.
Isaac, how you doing, man?
Good. He was supposed to spend the night with Tony.
Shortly before midnight, Tony suggests he and Isaac decamp to their hillside fort.
Oh, man, you take this game seriously. I gotta hit the sack, dude.
Yeah, you too.
I'm gonna keep my eyes open. So what are we up to tomorrow?
I don't know yet.
Isaac acted like he was wrestling around getting something out of the items he brought and got behind Tony.
He slits his throat so deeply it goes into his spine, practically decapitates him. It was over in seconds.
Shaken and rattled, Isaac hastily covers up the murder scene and creeps back down the hill and into the Dutcher home. But his deadly night is far from over.
At about 4 o'clock a.m., John Matheny reappears, comes into the back door with an assault rifle.
Isaac, what are you doing, man? I can't move.
You gotta get up, dude, come on.
Jonathan hands Isaac a flashlight and suggests they charge the grandparents' bedroom.
Remember why we're doing this.
I know.
Carl Dutcher came out.
Tony, is that you? Tony?
Joanna Dutcher comes out of the bedroom.
No!
And John Matheny proceeds to shoot her, but misses several shots.
Please don't hurt.
And she runs into the bathroom.
Jonathan unloads the rest of the AK's magazine.
There are bullets all over. Sheer terror. And about 6 shots kill her.
now to get what they came for.
They gather up the guns. This is when the gun case is dropped on the floor as they leave.
And then Isaac recalls one final chilling detail of that awful night.
A phone call is actually made by John Matheny to Simon Sue, who is in Canada.
We did it. It's done. Got it.
So it's you and Jonathan and Simon. Simon just orders it. He doesn't do anything that's too high.
Police arrest his accomplice, Jonathan, and the murder mastermind, Simon Sue. Gearhead Glenn is also charged as an accessory after the fact. Glenn pleads guilty and is sentenced to 2 years in prison.
Isaac also pleads guilty to murder in the second degree. He's sentenced to 60 years. John Matheny pleads guilty to conspiracy to commit murder and is given a 68-year sentence.
The general ultimately chooses to confess as well.
Simon Sue pleads guilty to conspiracy to commit murder and is given a 53-year sentence.
For the victim's loved ones, the fact Tony's grandparents were just collateral damage in a teenage military fantasy is a bitter pill to swallow.
When I found out it was Isaac, I felt incredibly betrayed. It's like Cain and Abel, because I thought of him as a son. But from what I understand, Simon Sue was very much into manipulation and mind control, and he had somewhat of a little cult.
Simon was a master chess player, and Simon saw something in them that made them look susceptible, and he knew what buttons to push.
Some kids are followers, and some kids are leaders. And that's what this case is about.
Even now, the charismatic leader is likely attracting a whole new group of dangerous followers. This time, at least, Simon's deadly army will be confined behind bars.